Hello.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. I'm good. Just been busy this morning, but this day actually goes by really fast somehow.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. We're really excited to have you here.
Thanks for having
and I know you need no introduction, but I just want to say that, you're as famous as the people that you blog about. And I was really, it was really good for me to know that your content reaches 40 million people a month, which is amazing. And I also personally know you as the founder of Girl Tribe because the work that we do is in a very, very similar space, although it's more career focused. So I do see that we have that common ground. So I have some questions for you. And then if we have time, we'll see what kind of questions are coming up on the live as well.
Sounds good.
All right. So I wanted to talk to you about how I see you as occupying this really intersectional space in Bollywood and media, right? You're in between Bollywood and the celeb world and the rest of us. You're also in between, running a business empire and also a social media influencer. And as a social media influencer, you've been there for a really, really long time. You started when blogging and social influencer, it wasn't a thing. So you've really seen that space grow and evolve. So how do you look at your position within that and your responsibility within that?
So I think, like you rightly said, we're kind of like a melange of different things. And while I started out my blog, I never meant to be an influencer or, do it as a business because there was no concept of that when I was starting out. I think over time, I've kind of found my groove in trying to promote positive journalism, especially in entertainment. So that's kind of been our space. So if you look at our content, we don't really do gossip. We do sort of more fun content. We do sort of, get to know celebrities on more of a humane level. And I focus now has actually been, like you said, Malini's Girl Tribe to sort of uplift women and help them. In fact, I don't know if you've seen, but today we launched our Ignore No More campaign, which is against sexual harassment and abuse and
Yes, I
trolling
saw that.
online. And I think that what's great is now we're able to combine our relationships with celebrities to actually make huge impact for women. And it's not necessarily always serious. We do fun things too. So, for instance, we did a virtual happy hour with Arjun Kapoor, and we have one with Rakulpreet today. So, it's about a mix of those things. So, if you ask me how I see myself, I mean, the goal and my dream, and I aspire to sort of be, I guess, the Indian version of Oprah in some small sense. So, I don't know if there's an equivalent that I can really give you an example of, but I really hope to be sort of a voice for millennials, for the next generation to sort of lead by example of spreading positivity, especially online, because now, especially after the coronavirus, we spend so much time online. It's a whole other virtual reality for us. So I think it's important for someone to sort of figure out how to clean it up.
Yes. And speaking of spending time online, I come across many people, young people, and I'm sure you do too, obviously, who want to be social media influencers. Like it's a legit career, right? But I want you to tell us what it takes to actually build a long-term, sustainable, profitable career on the internet, because it's not easy.
So there's different kinds of things, right? There's a lot of influencers who are solo influencers and they make quite a lot of money doing their posts and they're kind of their own boss in that sense. I think what we did is slightly different. We started off as a blog, then we became an entertainment company. So we started doing television shows and podcasts. And so it wasn't just about the blog anymore. And so for me, I have a team of 65 people. It's not just me at all, So I don't write every single blog, I don't write every single post. So it depends which direction you want to go in. Do you want to be more of an entertainment company that does a lot of different things? Or do you want to be a solo influencer? Both of them are legitimate. But the roles and the things that you would do are different. So for me, I have to wear many hats, right? So I also have to look at the business end, look at investors, look at numbers and targets and things. And as a solo influencer, you kind of really have to just work on what deals you want to do and build your identity and keep your connection with your audience alive. So it is very difficult. I think as a solo influencer, maybe there's a little more uncertainty, but there's definitely more freedom. And as you build a company, you definitely get, I guess, a little more established in the environment in a sense, because you have a larger piece to play. We do a lot more stuff with brands. We also have our own influencer network called Ignite, where we try to wanted to give back to the influencer community. So we help them find work as well. So they're two totally different, but two totally, legitimate ways to go.
And tell me, how did the idea of Girl Tribe come about?
So actually it happened by accident. Facebook is just launching groups and I was like, okay, I should try it out because I like to try new things and new features. And I was like, what should I make the group about? Should I make it about Bollywood or fashion or beauty? And I was like, you know, what if it's something that's a bit of a mix of everything? So I was like, let's make a group for girls, because again, you know, girls have a really hard time online. Or as you must know, your DMs are filled with, you know, some guy talking to himself every day, right? So I wanted to create a safe space for women, and I added 100 of my friends, and now it's 43,000 women, and they're super active, and we talk about everything from, you know, because I don't think there are women's issues are just rape and menstruation, right? It's about work and mental health and relationships. Absolutely. And travel and food. So it's just a community that I created, and it's really a piece of my heart now. This is where all my love and attention really lies. I feel like little Miss Malini has grown up to really want to do something with the girl tribe. And so it was by accident, but it was one of the best accidents I've had in my life.
Yeah, I've seen some of the conversations on the community, and I think that I've really seen that people open up a lot, and it is powerful to see that kind of vulnerability online. And I wanted to ask you, what do you think happens when women connect together in a community, in a safe space? What kind of change and transformation do you see?
I think women are such great supports, unfortunately, through the patriarchy, we've always been pitted against each other and told to be in competition with each other. But that doesn't need to be the case. And I think women really understand each other. We all have something in common and similar interests. And I love that whenever I did a Girl Tribe virtual or physical event, women are so quick to become friends and empathize and understand each other. So I think it's just been absolutely amazing. And so I think that the key goal and the things I've noticed are that women are able to really express themselves. Sometimes it's important for you to talk to a stranger more than someone you know, because it's something that you may not be able to share with the immediate family. There's a lot of girls who are talking about during Pride Month, how do they come out to their family? There's a lot of people who talk about domestic violence. A lot of people talk about, you know, running businesses during the coronavirus. So literally everything and anything. You also have some fun, inspiring posts. You have somebody who does tarot. So it's just a mix of all the things that we're interested in. And it's kind of right now, especially when you're stuck at home and you can't see anyone, you can walk into this community and interact with 43,000 women about different things. So you're not alone anymore.
Yeah. And also going back to some of the recent posts that you were sharing about sexual harassment online, the internet can be a very rewarding place, and it can be a very toxic place at the same time. Since we're talking about how to make the internet work for you, and you know how to make this work for you, tell us about that. How do you find that balance? You know, how do you find your centeredness within that, you know, space of always being online, some burning out sometimes, seeing the positivity, seeing the toxicity, all of that?
So for me, I have kind of an unorthodox way of detoxing. I don't get off the internet because I live there. Mm-hmm. And just like I live in the real world, I wouldn't disappear for days on end. So I don't disappear from there. But I decide what I'm going to spend my time on. So I unfollow accounts that have negativity or make me feel bad. I spend some time playing like fun, calming games. I listen to podcasts that, you know, I find inspiring. I really like to follow accounts that remind me about affirmations or positivity. I've started a show called Some Good News, which is really about that, focusing on happy things that are happening during the coronavirus. So I think that's my way of balancing and finding my center, is finding the happiness online. And like you said, there is a lot to gain from the internet. It's just important that we treat it like we would the real world. And I'm actually writing my second book on this topic. What, you know, behave the way online as you would in real life. And only say the things that you would say to someone, and you will realize automatically what a great self-check that is.
Yes, I heard your TED Talk and you mentioned that, and I felt that that is so correct, because I feel like if there's one thing you can take about your behavior and other people's behavior online, is to be like how you are in real life, you know?
Right.
I also wanted to talk to you about how you've evolved your content. And I know social media influencers face that a lot, right? You start out with something that becomes your niche. Maybe you start to make money in that niche, and then you grow as a person. When you faced this, what were you thinking? Because you grew from Bollywood gossip to what you're doing now. How did you make that process organic and seamless?
I think it happened kind of organically on its own. I'm very lucky that way. I think because we were, you know, because we kind of started off when there wasn't anyone in this industry, we were able to which way it's going to go and decide the path we were going to carve. And I'm very proud that a lot of people felt that, great, it's a legitimate career, even though it didn't exist before. So what happens initially, it was a hobby blog. I realized that internationally, we're seeing, you know, a lot of situations where they're turning into full. So, okay, great. Look at this as a business. I have a great business partner, Mike Melly. Then my husband, also the CEO now, Nashad, working with us. So it's something where it's not just about me. I have a very team who works on this, as I said. So we decided to think about the things we can add. And because we have a big team, we were in AMC, which is Agent M Creative, our in-house ad agency. We were able to add the Girl Tribe team. We have our in-house video team. We were able to do the television shows. So it all grew as we saw the need for the kind of content. I've always been a great believer of not needing your content to just sit on your site. I think people, you have to go to where the people are. So if they're on Facebook, go to where the party is. If they're consuming content on Snapchat or Instagram, you have to customize it. Like you see, like TikTok is a whole other world. People are consuming hours of content, 15 seconds at a time. So it's really about adapting. And I think that's what we've always done. We've tried to adapt.
And one of the things that I also admire about your content is that you've used the reach that you have because of Bollywood and the mass appeal that it has to talk about things and issues that are important. But I was also wondering that for people who start out with a niche, do you think it's possible for them to attain the kind of scale that you have without talking about subjects that have mass appeal in the way Bollywood does?
I think it's tough. I think that luckily for us, I mean, people, and it's a double-edged sword, right? People still think of me as a Bollywood blogger, which I'm not. I haven't been for years. And my team does that. But I think that we have found a good balance. So absolutely, I feel that why not? If you can ride on something that has mass appeal and send out a positive message, best of both worlds. So that's what we've tried. We also do fun entertainment content. We're not all serious. But you can find a way to balance it. So for instance, we'll do a fun yoga class with Malaika, or we'll do a session on somebody movie, but also then add in a fun element. I try to be the one degree of separation between celebrities and people, because it's such a nice feeling during the lockdown, especially when people are feeling sad and lonely. The great memory some people will have is, hey, I was in a happy hour with Rahul Khanna or Arjun Kapoor. And it's great that we give them that memory of this time, which is so tough. So that's kind of how we try to find a balance.
Yeah. And in the community itself, do you have moderators in the community? How do you ensure that the community stays a safe space for people?
I do. We moderate everyone who joins. We check their profiles to make sure they're legitimate. We every post before it goes out. We also have a bunch of threads. So we have communities and tops, so much content. Like, we get hundreds of posts every day. So you have to be very vigilant. And we do. And my team is amazing. The Girl Tribe team works day and night to make sure the content is legitimate, that there's no spam. We've done something called the Girl Boss Spotlight, and we've actually featured 100 women's businesses, and they've gotten a lot of business out of it. And because I think there's a lot of people working out of home right now and running their businesses. Yeah. So yeah, to answer your question, there's a team. We are very, very careful about what goes on the group. Also, if somebody has a disagreement, we moderate it. We're lucky that in the Girl Tribe group, people are not so attacking and abusive, but the internet and social media tendency is to be defensive and attacking. So we are very cognizant of if something breaks out, we do intervene and ask everyone to, you know, be empathetic and kind.
We also have, moderators, and we try to foster conversations that are progressive. So I see what you mean. I was also, like I mentioned, listening to your TED talk, and one of the things that stayed with me was that you said that, when you are on the internet and when you're doing things at the scale at which you are, you're thinking about unseeing the numbers and seeing the people. So seeing people as people, not as followers or as likes. But at the scale at which you operate, how do you make that possible? Because like we mentioned in the beginning, 40 million people, you know, reaching 40 million people is not a joke. So how do you take that ethos and, apply that ethos at scale?
So I think the thing that I've learned, and I may not have known this over time, is you have to acknowledge people. Like right now, people are watching this live. So hi, Sanya. Hi, Ethan. I'm going to call you after this, as you can see why I didn't pick up the phone. This May 18 just joined the Girl Tribe. Sometimes all it takes is a little acknowledgement. People just want to witness. So I've made a conscious decision, instead of going and just liking people's posts or just putting an emoji, I take some time to reply at length. So I may not be able to reply to everyone, but the ones I do, I reply with a lot of thought. So I think you have to do that. And people will understand that you can't be responsive to every single person. But if you make an effort to do it with some people, that is what they will remember. And so our goal now, as and obviously a business is also a business, right? You do have to look at the numbers, you want to grow them. Yeah. But at the same time, you have to acknowledge that these are real people. They are not numbers. They have things they're going through. And right now, everybody is going through exactly the same thing. We are all, you know, sitting at home, worried about getting sick, feeling lonely, wondering what the future holds. So there's a great deal that you have in common right now with people that you may not have thought you had, you know? So I'm trying to do little things. I'm working on my Hindi. So I'm major lives karti hu, main Hindi mein bolti hu, so I can connect with more people. Because I think it's important, you know, I think it's important to learn new skills, and nobody will ever mind if you make an effort with them. Nobody will ever take that the wrong way. If you stop and say, hi, how are you feeling today? What's going on? It makes a big difference. And you don't have to do something hurt every time. Sometimes it's just saying, I see you.
Yeah. Yeah. Just looking at some of the comments, there was a question here around balancing between the content that you want to make and branded content.
Sure.
Would you like to say something about that?
Yeah. So what we try to do is we try to make sure we work with brands that we feel good about. So for instance, I'll never do anything with a fairness cream. I don't know if I'm frozen for you. I look frozen for myself.
I can hear you. You look frozen, but I can hear you very well. Yes. I can see you now.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so I think that, you know, what we try to do is we try to balance it out. So what we always try to hope for is, how does our branded content help our audience? So if we can do something where people benefit from it, we definitely do that. It is a business, so yes, we work a lot with different brands, and we also try to get a lot of influencing going. So that helps feed the influencer marketing ethos, you know, ecosystem. So a lot of influencers make money off that. So that's also something we love to do. We try to do positive messaging and try to get the right equality message out there. So for instance, like I said, we won't do anything that body shames. We won't do anything that, you know, preys on negative emotions. So I think the balance that you have to find is, think about the fact that everyone who buys something, they're doing it because they want to feel good about themselves. They want to impress their friends. They want to stand out. So when you sell them something, do it with integrity, because everybody needs stuff. It's not like people don't want to buy things. They just don't know what to buy. And sometimes they look at a glossy magazine and it's a bit intimidating. So we try to be the virtual BFF, that if Milan has lace and monochrome on the runway, what does that mean for my wardrobe? So it'll help you pair the lace shorts with the black gunji and help you feel good. So it's literally that. Let's say hi to Vivek, the Bi Vices, for always following all the lives. It's very sweet of you. And Henna as well. So I think it's really, really important for us that we balance out the content we do. But obviously, we do have sales targets. So we have an entire team that works on that and client servicing. But we're very happy that every brand we've worked with, I have no cringy memories about having done that. I'm not ashamed of any brand I've worked with. Mm-hmm.
That's so important. And it's nice to hear that you do feel like that. I have a question here from Rajlakshmi around any struggles and challenges that you faced while you were building the Girl Tribe.
Yeah, I think the struggle is spreading the word, which is why I love talking to everyone and say, honestly, the Girl Tribe is not something where I'm trying to make money off of it. I really feel it's a community that helps women. It's, you join, and once you see the conversations, you will be amazed. You will not feel alone. And eventually, I want to be able to create a community where guys can join too. It's just unfortunate right now. It's difficult because of the kind of trolling women get. But I think that it's just, you know, I think the most important thing about the Girl Tribe is just being able to be yourself. And I really feel that it has so much potential. I'll give you an example. You know, there was a girl who was asking, you know, a mom. She said, I found my daughter on her phone and she's looking at porn and she's 12. What do I do? And a lot of people gave a great advice saying, look, don't shame your daughter. She already feels bad about age. They are starting to wonder about this, and you have to explain to her how the birds and the bees were, to explain to her the difference between love and sex and porn and all these things, because she needs this information, because right now kids are getting this. But imagine if she had put up this question on regular social media. It would have been just the kind of comment she would have gotten. So I think you would have been able to. So I think the struggle with Girl Tribe is, one, explaining to people what value it add. It's not just any mm-hmm. other community. It's really a community of empathy, hopes, and friendship, the kind of, you know, we function on those values and positivity. And I think the other struggle is literally getting the word out, getting people to be part of it. And part of it is also helping people unlearn social media, not be yeah. snappy and not be negative and not get angry. They have differing mm-hmm. views. We have to agree to be respectfully.
Yes, and also to find the strength that then comes, you know, that shows up when you are supporting each other, which is also, you know, so the struggles that you mentioned are some of the same struggles that we have. And I do find what you're saying very valuable. I've been watching some of the interviews that you do with people, and I love how friendly, how self-assured you are. And of course, I know that you've been doing this for a long time, so it's second nature for you. But do you ever have self-doubt when you do that? And how do you deal with that?
When I self-doubt, when I do what? Sorry?
You know, when you are... when you're interviewing celebrities, you know, when you're out there, you're speaking in public.
I have crippling stage fright. People don't know this about me, but I am so, so nervous before I go on stage to this day. When I was doing my TED Talk, I rehearsed in front of the mirror for 2 months because I was so petrified. I just feel very self-conscious in front of an audience. I feel very nervous. I wonder what people are going to think of me. I look at the audience, and if I don't see someone smiling and nodding back, it makes me very insecure. So please don't be fooled if you see me always looking like I have stuff under control. I absolutely do not have it under control, but I'm learning to feel more self-confident. I learned from someone this great thing that women all have this voice in their head that says, you can't do it. Look how bad you look. Or people say, you have to start identifying that voice as a roommate. Just like sometimes we all have that messy, mm-hmm. annoying, difficult roommate. Imagine that voice is a roommate in your head, but it's not you. So leave that room. You go to live your life and do things and understand that this is just someone you have to be empathetic with, someone you live with. But
yeah, thank you for saying that. That makes a lot of sense. Also, how has the lockdown helped you? How have you been working during the lockdown? How have you been connecting, reaching out, just also facilitating the connections of the girl tribe and the community during the lockdown?
I mean, the great thing is we live online, so I haven't actually had to shut anything down. My entire company works with Zoom chats and Google Hangouts, so we're doing that. Initially, I was feeling a bit out about being at home because I have to mm-hmm. write my book, and I had these grand plans of sitting at Soho House and writing my book, which is now complete. A wash, but I'm enjoying writing it, and I'm hoping to finish it so I don't have to remain in lockdown once everybody is out and about. But I you know, an interesting thing has happened to me. I've gotten a little used to this, and I don't mind so much. Mm-hmm. I've realized the things that are important to me, so I don't really need to go out clubbing and meet 100 people. I just want to see a few of my friends that I will see in person. I really miss them. I miss seeing my family.
Yeah.
But aside from that, I feel much more efficient. I don't have to spend hours in hair and makeup. I don't have to go and wait for hours on a shoot. I'm saving on travel time. I've, you know, created my little cocoon of space, and I feel quite productive. So, and the Girl Tribe is actually a great place that's really thriving right now because people really need that support system. So, and I love that we found a way to do virtual events, you know, so we are able to do Girl Tribe events where literally we can dial in people from all over the world. So we had someone from Australia yeah. and Sweden and Bahrain and Singapore, yeah. and we've been doing these really fun happy hours. And you know, I encourage the girls who are watching, come and join. It's free. And we do some really fun ones. We're going to be doing one with Sushmita Sen, which I'm super excited about. I love her. So I'm really happy that the virtual world is allowing me to do all this, but which is why I want to clean up the trash we read online, because that's bothering me a great deal.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And what's next for you? What's the next big thing?
So I have to write this book that's on my mind a lot. We're going to be launching a Girl Tribe app soon, which I'm super excited about. We're also, you know, expanding out our content in the South Indian cinema, probably regional languages. We're building out a lot of the things we're going to do. So I'm going to be doing hosting a show very soon, as soon as the lockdown's over.
On the
platform. So yeah, super excited about all these things. They're all a little bit on pause right now, like the whole world is.
Wonderful. I have one last question here from Vishal. He says that he sees you as a cool kanya. So what does being a cool kanya mean to you?
Great, and thanks, Vishal. I think being a cool kanya is literally being yourself. I think that nowadays people tell you different things. And if you look at the generations, there were different things that were cool at different times, right? I think right now, my definition of a cool kanya is someone who is living her own life, working hard, playing hard, someone who has empathy and who is positive and is spreading love. I think that's pretty cool.
Thank you so much for saying that. What a lovely definition. I love that. Want to be mindful of your time. So thank you so much for joining. It was an absolute pleasure hosting you.
And thank you for having me.
Yes. All right. Everyone, thank you for joining. Okay. Thanks. Bye.
And bye. Thanks, Pramila. That's very sweet of you to say. Bye, guys. See you.